Good evening. Thank you all for coming out this evening. I'd like to call the January 12, 2017 school committee meeting to order. This is our second of many budget meetings. We'll start with public comment. I'd ask that the comment not be on agenda items. So if you're here to talk about or listen to or participate in what we're discussing tonight, hold your comments till that point. But if you came to talk about something that isn't on the agenda, we're going to start with that. We have a quick consent agenda for a really phenomenal high school field trip for Habitat for Humanity over the summer. We'll do reports. We did the Monday night, so I'm guessing that will be very short. There shouldn't be too much new. And the bulk of the meeting tonight will be on the FY 2018 proposed superintendent's budget. This evening, Dr. Doherty and his staff will be going over the Special Education Cost Center and District-Wide Services Cost Center, which includes things like athletics, extracurriculars, health services. At the end of the meeting, we will have a very brief executive session, and that will be that. So, is there anybody here tonight to not talk about the budget in terms of special education or district-wide services who would like to address the committee? I heard that there was someone. Yes, hi. For public comment, I'm going to ask you to come sit here. Usually at our normal meeting room, we have a table with a microphone so that RCTV can pick it up for recording. We don't have that here. So anyone who participates tonight, I will ask you to approach the mic, and if you could state your name.
Hello, I'm Tessa Goldlust.
Hi, Tessa.
And I have a letter regarding, I think, some of the topics from the last meeting.
Okay.
I'm an eighth grader at Coolidge Middle School, and today I speak as an advocate for some of my teachers that could lose their jobs either at this time or in a future budget cut. Some of them are Senor Barbera, my Spanish teacher, Ms. Lifshin, my Project Adventure teacher, and Ms. Pinkham, our school psychologist. Each of these people are extremely kind, invaluable, and have effective ways in getting their teacher across to their students. While none of them may teach core subjects, the value of their classes is not lesser. Every single day, I see kids light up when they realize that they have Spanish next period, myself included. They could care less about what we will be doing in class because Senora's enthusiasm makes learning fun. Same thing with Project Adventure. I have learned so many valuable lessons that I could never get from sitting down with a textbook in a classroom. Social and problem solving skills that can be applied to other classes and other obstacles in the real world. My time with Ms. Pinkham is spent on Friday mornings when she holds a stress management group that a couple of eighth graders and I attend weekly. There we put our troubles into perspective and focus on mindfulness. You may think that my listing of these attributes of these specific teachers is pointless considering I'll be moving on to the high school next year. That may be true, but those teachers touched me in a way that made me look forward to each day and learn new ways to grow as a student. I can confidently say that these teachers are some of the best that I've had during my time at Coolidge. The thought of them not being available to other students next year is what is giving me the courage to speak up for them today. I feel that it is partially my responsibility to ensure that future grades have the same opportunity to be inspired by these magnificent women. And this may be an extreme way of looking at things, but if you cut a math teacher, the subject of math still lives on. But if you cut a Spanish teacher, the teaching of foreign language in America dies a little. Everywhere else in the world, learning English is a necessary skill, but learning a foreign language here isn't mandatory until high school. For example, a loss in teachers like Ms. Lifshin results in a loss of Project Adventure, along with programs like the Michael Fallon Assembly and Challenge Day, which I know have changed many of us eighth graders for the better. I'm not expecting this message to save someone from getting fired or to cause someone who wasn't mentioned on this list to be let go instead. That isn't the goal. My goal is that this opened your eyes to how extraordinary these teachers are and the impact they made on me.
Thank you so much. So I'm getting a little emotional. So you are what makes it such a pleasure to serve on the school committee, even at times like this, when it is not easy to serve on the school committee, to see a young person like yourself, so articulate, so bright, such a beautiful writer, and so committed to her community. And that did take courage. That's not an easy thing to do. So I can't thank you enough for coming out here tonight. And we all will take your words to heart. I assure you of that. So thank you very, very much.
Yeah, Mr.
Is there anything anyone that would like to take off of the consent, or is take off of the consent agenda?
Okay.
I'd like to move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
All those in favor?
A second.
Oh, thank you for the second. 6-0, the consent agenda is approved. Reports. Alex, what's happening since Monday?
So a little repetitive, but on Monday, this Monday, there will be a Martin Luther King celebration at the high school. And the choruses at the high school will be singing, and we'd love for you to come. And also, there's an improv show next Friday, January 20th, in the pack at 7 p.m. And also, there's been a lot of talk about the news at the budget, and everybody's talking, everybody's coming up with ideas, so hopefully people will be in to talk more.
Great. Thanks, Alex.
Thank you.
Any committee reports this evening?
Alex just did mine.
Great. Yeah, it's a wonderful event every year, and it is free. It's a wonderful thing to bring kids to, but anyone would enjoy it.
And just to point out, these paintings by Rob Surrett that are in this library came from the Martin Luther King Day event 2 years ago. They're all role models that hopefully start children, students, adults talking about the important things that Tessa was referring to that go above and beyond the disciplines and that make our country and our world a better place for all of us to live in. So thank you, Tessa, and I hope to see you on Monday.
Jean, yeah.
You've been asked to speak up because the acoustics aren't very good in here.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Thank you. Any other committee reports? I have two brief ones. One is I have received, and I know I'm not the only one on the committee, several emails and phone calls about the budget. So what I've been doing is keeping a list, and when our process is when there's specific questions, we forward them to Dr. Doherty, and his staff presents them all. And the reason we do that is so that they can sit down and plow through them all at once to avoid redundancy, so they're not answering the same question 8 times. But most importantly, in my opinion, so that they can be included in the ultimate school committee budget, which means anybody at town meeting or in the future can look and say, well, did anybody ask these questions? And so it's not just something we talk about, they're printed. So I've been responding to emails, so you will get an acknowledgement of the email, but that's the beginning, not the end. So we think about the emails, we forward them to Dr. Doherty, and specific questions will be addressed. So I wanted to say that. Also, apparently, 2 nights ago, I did not see it firsthand, but at the Board of Selectmen's meeting, one member of the Board of Selectmen floated the idea that they should begin thinking about a potential override vote in April. There's an election already scheduled for April. That is really all that I know, that it is a discussion that's now happening that wasn't happening, as far as I know, before Monday night. So this is a new development. So I share it with the public for your information. And I share it with the committee because the 6 of us now need to begin to think about that. That's really all I have on that for tonight, to raise your awareness about it. There is a financial forum scheduled for January 25th, which is a Wednesday, with the Finance Committee, the Board of Selectmen, the School Committee will all meet jointly. I think there'll be more discussion at that point. Yes, Mr. Doxer?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Doxer is the chair of our town's finance committee. Yeah, I will say that I attended a little bit and watched much of last night's selectmen's meeting, and as there may be people in this room who are really focused on the school budget, I know the selectmen are struggling with some challenges as well on the municipal side of our budget. Yeah, Mrs. Webb.
I would just like to say, although Mr. Doxer just said it's for the community to talk and not the boards to talk at the financial forum, I think the financial forums are an incredibly important aspect of our townwide governmental processes, where they bring together schools and municipal, and really the department heads are usually there, John and his staff are usually there. And I think it's an imperative, and I want to apologize to the public that I have a commitment in Cambridge and I will not be able to attend, and I am sort of distraught over that, but perhaps it would be more of a listening time, so I will be able to watch the tape on our CTV, but I really encourage people. Those are some of the most important forums that we have in this community for people to provide input, and the boards are there to listen.
Yeah.
So,
thank you. Thank you. I think that's it from the committee. Dr. Dorey.
I do not have anything. I think we'll be saying enough.
You want to say something about executive session minutes, I think.
No.
Aren't we releasing a couple?
They're already released.
Oh.
They're on the website.
April 26th, the October 13th?
Yes, all of the executive session minutes, except for, there's like, I think, three more.
That we're approving tonight and will be posted tomorrow.
And they will be released tomorrow morning.
Great.
But it is now on the website. It is up and running. It's under the school committee tab. And then if you go down, there is a special tab for litigation.
All right. Do you want to start with special education or district-wide tonight?
We're going to do special education first. I do want to thank everyone for coming tonight. We have several administrators and directors here this evening for both the special education and the district-wide services budget. So I'm going to turn over the special education piece. The bulk of it will be done by Carolyn, and then I'll do the last few slides for special education. And just like the other evening, we'll have the question piece at the end of the cost center.
Thank you. And just to repeat that, there will be an opportunity to ask questions both from the committee and the public, but we would like to let them get through this section of the presentation, because sometimes you have a question and three slides later it's answered.
Yes. Okay, so I am going to focus on the special education cost center tonight. I'm going to provide you with an overview of special education, talk specifically about what we do here in Reading, and then we'll go through some of the budget pieces. But I wanted to provide you with kind of a context so that everyone is understanding what drives the costs in the special ed cost center. So just taking a look at the overview, again, 30.5% of the total budget is special education, and you can see what the cost center funds here. These are all the pieces that are in this cost center. So under student services, the goal is to provide high quality programs and services within the district and to identify and place children in out of district programs only when the programs or services that are offered within our district are not adequate or appropriate to address a child's particular needs. As mandated by the Individuals with Disabilities Act in Section 504 of the Americans with Disabilities Act, we strive to provide programs and services to allow our students with disabilities to be educated in the least restrictive environment that enables them to make effective progress. I think that's really important, and I'm going to go through and define some of those terms just so people have an understanding of how this works. So some of the terms you'll hear a lot when we're talking in special education, I'm just highlighting, I'm not going into great depth around the special education process, but I'd be happy to meet with any of the members of the committee or the public about this process. So an IEP is an individualized education program that's developed for students with disabilities who require specialized instruction. When we talk about free appropriate public education, we call that FAPE. It's our obligation. If a student requires something to access their education, it needs to be free, which means at no cost to the family. It needs to be appropriate, and it needs to be as part of their public education. LRE is another term, so we talk about least restrictive environment. So when IEP teams are meeting to discuss students' needs, they need to look at whether or not the students can have their needs met in the general education or the least restrictive environment. We're always balancing those needs for students, and that's kind of the push that we have. We're looking at the least restrictive environment, and some students need opportunities to be in a separate setting, and the IEP teams consider that. IEP teams are the teams of individuals who determine eligibility. They develop the student's IEP, and they determine placement. So it's really important to understand that the IEP process is driven by the IEP team. And I think sometimes there's a perception that as a director of student services that I might be involved in that decision-making process. Unless I am part of that student's IEP team meeting, I would not be part of that determination. So where we have over 700 students on IEPs, it would be almost impossible to attend all those meetings and be an active participant. So It's just really important to keep that context in mind, that it is the IEP team that determines whether a student is eligible, and they determine what goals and services go in the IEP, and they are the ones who determine placement. A team chair in our district, a team chair is not a regulatory requirement. We have this position, many districts have a team chair or a special ed coordinator or evaluation team chair. There are all kinds of different names for this position. We call it a team chair. In our district, it is an administrator who coordinates the special education process. Most of our team chairs at the elementary level are shared between buildings. Each of our middle schools has their own team chair, and at the high school, currently, we have 1.7 team chair. They attend all initial eligibility meetings and reevaluations, and they attend the annual meetings for students who are in our programs. They work very closely with our building principals to oversee special education services within the building. So they're really a support to our principals in helping oversee special education on the day-to-day basis. So, to determine eligibility, we start with what we call an initial evaluation. Parents can absolutely request an evaluation if they suspect that their child has a disability. We also have what we call a child find obligation. So as a district, we need to reach out to families. We do this at the preschool level. We also put an ad in the paper and let families who may not be sending their children to the public schools know. And within our schools, we are always, through our SST process, our student support teams, looking to see if we suspect a student has a disability. If we suspect a child has a disability, or a parent puts us on notice that they suspect their child has a disability, we have an obligation to evaluate that child. Once we receive consent from a parent to do the evaluation, we have 30 school days to complete the evaluation, and then we need to kind of wrap up the initial eligibility process in a total of 45 school days. So we really have kind of a tight turnaround in terms of how we need to go through the process. At that initial eligibility meeting, the IEP team is charged with determining whether a student has a disability. The IDEA, the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, defines 10 categories of disability that we use for educational purposes. So it's not a diagnostic criteria that you would see in a clinic. Our definitions are educationally based, and that's what our teams use to make that determination. So the team first needs to determine if a student has a disability as defined under IDEA. And then the next question the team needs to answer is the student making effective progress in school? Which that is a conversation that needs to happen at the team level. And then the next question is the lack of progress a result of the disability? And finally, does the student require specially designed instruction or a related service to access the curriculum? So that's how we determine if a student would be placed on an IEP. If a student is then found eligible, we would develop the IEP, put into place the goals, the services, and then determine the placement for that student. I've put a link to a document that is called Is Special Education the Right Service? It's through the Mass Department of Education. It's a great resource to give you some more information about how we determine eligibility and what questions we might be asking as we go through the process. So here in Reading, we have a number of specialized programs that we have made available to our students. And so this is a listing of our programs. So I'll start with the Connections program, which is located at Birch Meadow, Coolidge, and Reading Memorial High School. As you can see, all of our programs run vertically because we want to be able to meet students' needs from elementary through high school and post-secondary if necessary. They're also, some of them are aligned with what we're doing at the Rise Preschool because our obligation is for students to provide services from age 3 to 22. So it starts at that age 3. So the Connections program is for students who are identified on the autism spectrum who require support around social skill development. This is a full inclusion program, and it's generally supported by a special ed teacher and or a paraprofessional, really in an inclusion setting, focusing on teaching social skills, and as the students move to middle and high school, really helping with some of those executive functioning and social skill and study skill needs that students have as they get older. The Compass program, which we have at Birch Meadow, Woodend, Coolidge, and the high school will be for next year, is a substantially separate program, which means that those students spend the majority of their time in a separate setting. The students in that program have either an autism spectrum disorder or they require intensive instruction and might have multiple disabilities. They are taught in a separate environment. As I said, we use the principles of applied behavior analysis, and we have a very low adult to student ratio in those classrooms for safety, but also for instructional purposes. The Crossroads program. This is located at Woodend, Coolidge, and the high school. These are students who have cognitive impairments, and this program allows us to really look at students who might have more complex cognitive profile and provide really individualized services. Those students have the opportunity to participate in inclusion opportunities and also to be taught very specialized in a separate setting. Again, these students require a low adult-to-student ratio, and if they are in the inclusion setting, they need support from a paraprofessional or a special education teacher. The Bridge program is at Joshua Eaton, Parker, and Reading Memorial High School. The Bridge is for students who are identified with language-based learning disabilities, so these are typically students who you would think of would go to the Landmark School, if you're familiar with that school. We actually model our program after Landmark and use them for consultation in this program. It is a partial inclusion program. We provide intensive remediation and instruction using language-based methodologies. We use specialized reading, and depending on the level, in terms of elementary, middle, and high school, and also depending on the individual student, they have opportunities for small group instruction in ELA, math, potentially history, and also access to specialized reading instruction. The learning centers, it's not really a program. It's where we meet the needs of students who may just need some support in class or some pull-out time. We have learning centers at all of our schools that are staffed by special education teachers and some paraprofessionals. Generally, our special ed teachers who work within the learning center have training in specialized reading program. Many of them have training in also writing programs, as well as teaching executive functioning. And so students who access the learning center are students who might need inclusion support, so support during their general education instruction, or they might need support, more specialized support in a pull-out model. The Therapeutic Support Program, TSP, this was formerly known as SSP and TSP, and we merged it into one. This is at Killam, Coolidge, and the high school, and it's for students who have an emotional impairment. And so this program is staffed at each level with special education teachers, paraprofessionals, and counseling staff. As you'll recall, in last year's budget, we added a full-time social worker to the Killam program in order to provide that therapeutic component that's really needed for this type of programming. And finally, we have our POST program, which is Providing Opportunities for Successful Transition. This is our collaboration with the Wakefield Public Schools. It's for students age 18 to 22 who have completed their time at Reading Memorial High School, but still continue to require special education services to help them focus on their transition goals, life skills, vocational opportunities. Those students are typically out in the community. They are taking buses. They are participating in jobs and internships in the community. And they really are also hosting social events. We actually went to their Thanksgiving celebration that they had, and their space has a kitchen in it, and it has a TV and a leisure space, and they're really working on those skills they need in order to move to adulthood. So those are our programs. We 2 years ago had Walker Associates come out and review our programs and our services, and I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the things we've implemented this year. So this school year, the things we implemented that have had a fiscal impact, because I wanted to differentiate that, is the social worker at Killam, which has made a huge difference in our programming. It has not only allowed us to have a much stronger therapeutic program by having a social worker who can be the case manager, who can support those students therapeutically, but it also has allowed us to free up the school psychologists in at Killam to complete the evaluations that need to get done and support the other students in the building, which last year was often a struggle because she would be pulled in to support the needs of the therapeutic program. So we're very happy with the change. We feel like the staffing is allowing us to do some very different things this year and really support some students who previously may have gone out of district, which is really exciting. We actually had a student return, two students return this year, and Killam has been able to support them quite nicely. So. We also, one of the recommendations is that we needed to provide more clinical supervision for our counseling staff. They are the front lines. They are dealing with students day in and day out who have all different needs as they come through our doors. And so one of the things, I've worked closely with Sarah Bird, who's our Director of Social Emotional Learning, and we used some grant funding last year, and this year we're using some funds from the operating budget to provide clinical supervision for our school psychologists and our school counselors. So they're able to get clinical supervision, and in addition, Sarah's been providing a lot of direct support to our therapeutic support programs to really help support those teachers who have some pretty challenging students in their classrooms day to day, and is kind of strengthening the communication we're having between administration and those programs as well. So those are two things that have a fiscal impact. The second one, not as great a fiscal impact, but I just wanted to draw that to your attention. Some of the other pieces of the recommendations we received that we have been doing, I think we had mentioned to you previously, the finding was that our DCAP, or our District Curriculum Accommodation Plan, had not been widely known by staff, and it's an important piece to help support all learners. And so we've really made a push during last school year and this school year to continue to make the DCAP available to staff, to parents, to the community. Both Parker and Coolidge, so one of the recommendations from the Walker report is that our small group instruction that's happening at the middle school level is really, their feeling was it was very intermixed between programs, and it was based on teacher more adult needs, adult schedules. And so I've been doing a lot of work with both Parker and Coolidge to ensure that our small group instruction and our counseling groups are really based on student need and not based on schedule. The third bullet is about our PLC work. So really, we need to do a better job getting that program description information out and entrance and exit criteria. With our new website, we're hoping to get that up this year. But our PLCs have really been doing that hard work of looking at their programs and looking at their entrance and exit criteria. Another area where Walker had made some recommendation is about, how do we determine if a student needs the support of a paraprofessional? So how is that determined? And so last year we rolled out a process with our principals and team chairs to be used at IEP teams to help guide the discussion. So we've created a rubric, and we've created some observation documents to help guide the discussion so that we have more uniformity around how we determine when we need to use a paraprofessional and how much time that is. It's not perfect, but at least it provides us with some guidelines and some kind of criteria that our teams are using to make those determinations. And then the last bullet, and I know we talked about the high school guidance a couple meetings ago, but I just wanted to bring up, this was another piece that the Walker report had highlighted as something we needed to do, was to move away from the one-to-one model, and our high school guidance department has begun to shift away from that, so they're doing more small group instruction. So just wanted to highlight a few things that we have been doing, and these really don't have a lot of fiscal impact on how we're operating. Areas that have not been addressed, I think you saw these multiple times. You know, it's really a space issue, which I think we're all aware of, that, you know, enhancing our program, some of the challenges do become a space issue. We talked about the assistant director and the need for, you know, the Walker report talked a lot about the supports within my office and how to ensure that we have the appropriate supports. And the last bullet is really the work we're doing as an administrative team around defining co-teaching. It's interesting, I was at a meeting Monday where they talked about, you know, can anyone define an inclusive school? And I think it's just, it's hard because everyone has a different definition, but it's something we continue to work on. We're sending some staff to some training coming up this month on co-teaching because we're continuing to look at how we can better support inclusion models within our schools. So I think some of you have seen this chart before. Really, we wanted to kind of take a look and show, based on FY16 numbers, the comparison of the cost of some of our in-district programs to out-of-district costs. And I want to point out, Dr. Doherty had talked about this slide earlier with the budget parents. I think another important piece here is that this chart shows 12 years. For students who would typically be in this type of a program, they may be with us for longer than 12 years. So I just think that's important to recognize that we would, some of these students will be with us until they're 22, and we'll be servicing them for that amount of time. So this is just some rough numbers to kind of look at. They're not exact science, but it gives you some rough estimates of the cost. I know there's been a lot of conversation about the accommodated cost piece, and we can talk about that maybe at the end. But this is just to show you some of the costs, what it costs us to educate a student in district versus an out of district. And that was for the Compass program. This is for the Bridge program, which there is not a public collaborative that you can compare the Bridge program to. Landmark is currently right now the only approved private special education school that provides this type of programming. So that just gives you a sense of the cost comparison. So now I'm going to shift and talk about more of the budget piece because I wanted to give you that overview. So our major cost center functions are curriculum directors, and you'll see the things that fall under there, school curriculum leaders, and instructional coordinators. And then we have instructional teaching services, and you'll see all the staffing that falls under there. So all the staff in the buildings who provide special education services fall under this cost center. And then some of our other costs in here, you'll see like we pay the collaborative dues, we do Medicaid claiming, which we've talked about previously, so there is a cost associated with that. And within this cost center, we also have the tuition for public collaboratives, private residential school, private day schools, as well as our legal services budget that we have for special education. These legal services are for any student-related issue, so it's not just special education. It could be a discipline issue. Anything that's student-related falls under this. Yeah, handbooks, any staff training by our legal counsel fall under this legal services. So it's not all for special education costs. So major changes, obviously the cost of living adjustments and step and column increases that we've talked about for the other cost centers impact this cost center. Cost of living adjustments for non-represented personnel. We have a reduction of a 0.5 FTE, a special ed administrator, that's the team chair. A reduction of a 0.6 FTE for the RISE preschool teacher, which is the music. We have a slight decrease in our circuit breaker reimbursement that we received last year. An increase of $50,000 in the RISE offset, which is we're gonna talk about that tuition increase because you'll need to approve that. And we have an increase of 2 FTE of elementary special ed teachers. We're adding those positions in this current year, and we're proposing to keep them in next year's budget. So this is just a summary of the changes and a summary of the impact. I'm gonna go into the impact a little bit more, but this is a summary of what I just talked about. And the last piece there that I didn't mention on the previous slide is about the restructuring of consult funds to create a 0.5 BCBA. So the reductions in this budget are that we are going to be reducing the professional development line to zero. That is concerning, I will say. There are things that we are mandated to do, but it is our goal to use our program improvement grant our funding through the IDEA grant. We also, you all accepted a generous donation from Samantha's Harvest, so we do have a gift account. So we're hoping that through those mechanisms, we'll be able to provide the professional development that we need. It should be noted that grant funding does put some limitations on how we can utilize those funds, so we won't have the freedom to send people to as many workshops. It's really going to be limited as to what the grant parameters allow us to do. But within these two grants, we feel that we can provide most of the professional development that we'll need to offer staff, and we're beginning the planning now of offering things now in planning for next year. So the impact of personnel reductions, the 0.5 team chair position. This reduction, so as you know, this year we increased the Joshua Eaton from a 0.5 to a 1.0. This is bringing us back to where we started this school year. It doesn't necessarily mean that Joshua Eaton isn't going to have a 1.0. We haven't gotten that far in sort of looking at what this may impact, but it will result in higher caseloads for our team chairs across the district and potentially out of district. And it's less support for both our special ed teachers and I didn't put up here for our principals. So it's not ideal, but it's putting us back to where we started this school year at and the level that we were at last school year. And we were able to manage the caseload. Again, we haven't, as of today, kind of determined how that's all going to flesh out. There's a lot of moving parts, but we feel confident we can do what we need to do with that reduction. The 0.6 FTE RISE teacher, which I believe Dr. Doherty spoke about, is the music teacher position. So the music sections of RISE will be taught by music staff across the district, which is going to result in a reduction of sections and courses at other levels. So the increase of BCBA. So what I am proposing in this budget is that we take funding that falls under our contracted service or consultation lines and we structure that into a 0.5 BCBA. We currently have a 1.0 BCBA for the entire district. Her focus has been on the Compass program, the Connections program, and the Crossroads program, as well as the POST program. That is potentially interacting with about 92 students. She doesn't necessarily interface with all those students on a daily basis, but there's the potential there. She's very limited to those programs because expanding her beyond that would become almost impossible to do the job. So the benefits to us of having someone in district is it's someone that's available on a regular basis to our staff. It decreases our need to send out for consultative services for FBAs or consult. It gives us increased support because having someone in district means we can be responsive to teachers, to special ed staff, much quicker than if we have to now reach out to SEAM or another agency and wait for them. This year, SEAM has had a backlog and some of our services aren't even available until February to provide because they have such a backlog of services. So just taking a look.
I can't answer that.
Sorry, Siri.
That'd be great, though. Yeah, Siri could just solve this whole thing for us.
We didn't even ask. So I just wanted to provide you with some current numbers from our BCBA. So she provides 27 consults based on student IEPs. This is across 9 buildings because that includes the RISE preschool. It equals roughly 18 and a half hours per week. She provides 12 home consults per IEPs, equaling roughly 16 hours per month. She provides program consults to Compass, Connections, Crossroads, and the POST program. And this year, so far, she has completed 6 FBAs, 2 home assessments, and 1 vocational community assessment. I also provided you below what it costs us for consult. So if we utilize SEAM, it costs us roughly $110 an hour. We've started using this other agency because SEAM hasn't had the available staffing. That costs us $120 an hour. And when we need to complete a functional behavioral assessment, it requires up to 15 hours. So it's costing us roughly $1,650 per FBA. Right now, we currently have a need for almost $20,000 in BCBA consult that is outside of the staff that we have. So the proposal is that we restructure $35,000 and put that into a 0.5 position, which is much needed for us. For a district this size, having one BCBA is very challenging. The increase of two FTE of special ed teachers. So our special education teachers provide specially designed instruction. They're trained in specialized methodologies to teach students. This year, our needs are at Wood End and Ashley Eden. At Wood End, it's for the Crossroads program. So the program started this school year with 8 students, and those students are K-5. It's a partial inclusion program. They have had 5 referrals from within our district from other elementary schools. And to date, they've had 2 students move in, so bringing them up to 10 students. And they're projecting next year to have 14 students in grades K-5. So there really is a need for an additional special education teacher so that we can provide the specialized services that those students need. And then at Joshua Eden, I've done a lot of work with Mr. Sprung and with the new team chair, Ms. Benjamin, around looking at the schedules, looking at the service delivery grids of the students that are at Joshua Eaton. And based on that work, we really feel they require an additional 1.0 special education teacher. What we're finding is a lot of the service delivery at Joshua Eaton is provided in a pull-out model, and we need to move to more inclusion, and we really can't do that without adding an additional teacher. We'd like to see that teacher provide some support for both our Bridge program and the Learning Center, and we'll see as we go through the process. I think we have just identified a potential candidate for this year. So that's really the need there for the two special ed teachers. So now I'm going to shift to Rise Preschool. So we are required to provide preschool programming for students with disabilities who require it the day they turn 3. So we never know, and I have Debbie here to attest to that. We never know who's going to show up and when they're going to need to be enrolled. It can vary on a day-to-day basis. So far, since the start of the school year, 6 students have been added to the Rise Preschool, and we're anticipating 2 more students to be joining next month. Last year, we had a significant number of students join us in April. That required us adding an additional teacher in April because their needs were so significant. So we can't always predict. We do our best. Like Debbie stays in close contact with early intervention, but we don't always know what is coming, so it's hard to anticipate. So I wanted to give you this information so when we talk about the tuition increase, you have a sense of how many students and families would be impacted by this. So the students who are not on IEPs are the ones who pay tuition. So what I provided you is some base numbers, as well as the different class options that we have. So we offer a lot of different options for preschool. We also have, for those students who are in the full day, we have extended day options that go through extended day for preschoolers, both at the high school and at Wood End. So this kind of gives you a sense of kind of our numbers. But these can change. Just like special ed numbers can change every day, the RISE numbers can fluctuate day to day, depending on our eligibility.
Jean, can I just ask?
Yeah.
Ms. Borowski, can I just ask a clarifying?
Yeah.
So the, just to be clear, so the additional students are?
The 55 additional students pay the tuition.
Right, and is that a requirement of the program by the state to have students in that are not receiving the services? Can you just clarify that?
You want to speak a little to the students?
It's an inclusion model, so we have, we do look for typically developing kids. So our integrated program has typically developing kids as well as a special ed kid. Originally, we were mandated to educate the special education students, but it's in everybody's best interest to have an integrated setting where we have model students as well as the special education students integrated into the same program.
And most public preschools have an integrated.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, it's definitely the way most public preschools are set up with an integrated model. So our proposal is to increase the RISE tuition by 5%. As I said, it's only for those who are not on IEPs. Tuition hasn't been raised since 2010. We've taken a look at area preschools to look at rate, and we feel that increasing by 5% will keep our rates comparable with area preschools. So this next slide is going to show you the hourly rate that we're looking to increase by and looking at the comparables. And I kind of took an average of the other schools. You take and found that with our increase, we are still going to be below the average of all of the preschools, the hourly average. So you'll see our current hourly rate for the 3 days AM is $7.50, 4 days AM is $7 an hour, 3 full days is $6.94 an hour, and the 4 full days is $6.25 an hour, and the 5 full days is $6.25. And then the highlighted is the proposed hourly increase.
What's the rate with the 5%?
That's the with the 5%. Yes, the blue. So the 5%, the highlighted bar is the proposed hourly increase. And as you can see, that still puts us really within the range of other preschools in the community.
Sure. I'm gonna take over now for the last few slides. This chart you saw for the other cost centers, looking at it by object, going through the professional salaries, as Carolyn mentioned, is based on both contractual increases, but also the increase in the two FTE teachers and the restructuring of the consultation services to the BCBA, which would be in this category. So that's why you see a higher percent change than some of the other centers that we've seen so far. The clerical is due to an increase in...
We hired someone, a new hire that was at a higher
rate. Oh, at a higher rate. Right, that's right. That's right. The other salaries include paraeducators. That's the primary, and then there's some other salaries in there. And well, the contractual services have gone up just a little bit, but that includes transportation, out-of-district tuition. The out-of-district tuitions is actually decreased in this year's budget, and transportation had a 0% increase for special education. So this is the one transportation area that did not increase in the budget. We do have a different transportation contract for special education. We're part of a consortium of communities that are through the SEEM Collaborative, where there's a shared cost based on different runs and routes to various locations. And then you see there's a decrease in supplies and materials and in other expenses. So overall, this is a 3% increase for this cost center. One of the things that I think we want to point out, and this is due to the hard work that Carolyn, the team chairs, the principals, and the teachers have put in over the last few years, is we are starting to see a downward trend in the number of students on IEPs, and also we're starting to see a decrease in students going out of district. Some of that is because students are aging out. Some of it, though, as Carolyn said earlier, that some of the students are coming back in district, which is why you do see the increase in staff at two schools, two teachers. So I think this really is due to the hard work of being more consistent in the eligibility process and determining what students really should be on IEPs, what students shouldn't. So obviously this is going to help us get down the road as we continue to go in this direction. And taking a look at the staffing chart, you can see the increase of 0.5 for the BCBA. You'll also see under elementary teachers, you see an increase of 2.0 FTE from last year. I do want to explain the high school, middle school piece. So there is a net there of 0. The high school is going up 1, the middle school is going down 1. It's because we now have a group of students moving from the middle school to high school, where we're, so we are going to be relocating a teacher from middle school to high school as the program continues up.
And the team chair, I just want to clarify, we actually have two team chairs who are on the IDEA grant. So it's not represented in there. So it is six, it's higher than that number. Is it two team chairs?
I believe so.
Yeah.
And those are in the grant funding.
Yeah, they're in the grant funding, which is in the back of the book. So that doesn't represent all of the team chair.
So we just flipped to page 62 and 63. So we want to, again, we want to go into a little bit more detail before we open it up to questions. Actually, I think it's, 62, 63, right. You can see as you go into a little bit more detail, the increase in professional salaries, which I already mentioned, and it's broken down under professional salaries to the different areas, the different positions under that category, including the revolving fund support. That revolving fund support is from primarily the out-of-district tuition and the RISE tuition revolving accounts for that increase. If you recall, in FY16, we bumped up for 1 year, because we had a decrease in circuit breaker, the out-of-district tuition offset to make up for that difference in circuit breaker, but we went back down again the next year for sustainability purposes. So you see the line item labeled special education teacher has gone up 11.6%, and that is because that's where the increase of the two FTE are, in addition to the cost of living adjustments. And the clerical salaries, which Carolyn already talked about, was an increase in a staff member that was brought in at a higher rate. District-wide leadership is the decrease.
That's tutoring.
That's the tutoring services, so you see a decrease there. Mm-hmm. And that's for home hospital?
Yes.
That's for the home hospital tutoring?
Yes, we don't know why it's titled that way. But
yeah. That's, yeah. So, sorry, that district-wide leadership,
yeah,
under contract
tutoring.
Services?
That's
tutoring.
It's tutoring, yeah. We don't know why it's labeled. That. These are DESE language.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes it makes sense, sometimes it doesn't make sense.
I think the other thing to note in the chart, so you'll see a lot of movement. Gail and I did a lot of work at looking at actual expenditures. So if you actually look at FY14, FY15, FY16 actuals, we readjusted what we were putting in the FY18 based on actual spending and not based on the budget, because we felt we wanted those line items to actually reflect how much we need in those areas. So when you see some of that movement, it's because we were looking at actual spending, and that's why the chart, I think, is helpful, because you can take a look back at 14, 15, and 16 and see what we actually spent.
So the similar approach we took when we talked about the regular days, we really tried to do a bottoms-up approach to really look at exactly what we needed and where we were spending it, so that we're not moving money around throughout.
So at this point, we'll take questions.
I have a few. Is that all right?
Yeah, that's fine.
Sorry. On the just a question on the grants. What's the time frame? When are those in?
So the IDEA grant usually comes out in August. It goes August to August, so we have until August 31st.
Okay.
The program improvement grant is one through the Department of Education, and it varies. Sometimes it's made available to us in the summer, and other times, like this year, it comes out in late October. So it varies, but that one also goes through August 31st, in terms of us being able to utilize that grant.
So we won't know until after this budget's been...
Correct. We won't know until the
right.
fall,
okay.
usually.
On the reduction in the team chair, I remember I'm just questioning it whether, because I remember a lot of discussion last year when we put that in, that it was going to relieve staff and of paperwork and just and we're going backwards.
Yeah, unfortunately, it seems to be a recurring theme that we're going backwards. You know, and as I think I said on Monday night, a lot of the decisions that we're making are the least of the bad decisions, and we're trying to minimize impact as much as possible, and that's why you see cuts and reductions in areas that in the past we've been advocating for, but we know that with this difficult budget, there are just things that we're going to have to live with, and this is one of those areas.
On the BCBA, is that, would that end up being a benefited position, the 0.5 benefited position?
No, 0.6 and above.
Okay, that, I can't remember, was that, I know we, it was part of the override discussions initially, did it make the final number when we went out?
I believe it was in that list that we talked about, yes.
So it was a priority then?
Yes, yes.
That's what I was just trying.
I believe if I can, I believe that we were, it was for a 1.0, and we knew that 0.5 was going to come from consultation services, and the other 0.5 would come as a result of the.
I'm just trying to determine that.
Yeah, the override funding.
I'm just trying to determine that something that we deemed a priority in the fall is still.
Yes.
Where are we with the, we've gone over this. I just can't remember where we are with the high school reading teacher situation. Is that?
We are currently still using contracted services, but we do have a teacher who is pursuing getting Wilson certification, and hopefully by next fall she'll be Wilson certified and have completed the practicum. It does take a full year.
Okay. So the position is in the FY18.
It's in the budget. Yes, it's definitely in the budget.
Right now, as a
it's just an unfilled position.
Yeah, it's a contract versus a benefit position. How are we on? I'm just looking at the RISE numbers. How are we on space with RISE at this point?
We'll maintain seven classrooms. Eight classrooms next year.
One of them's really tiny. Mm-hmm.
They're small.
But we're all right, though.
Yes, we're not increasing the number of classrooms.
On the tuition cost comparison, and do we charge an hourly rate, or is that just the analysis?
No, that's just how we were breaking it down.
We were trying to show the comparisons. It's different.
We charge a monthly tuition.
So what's that go from to? You don't have to, if you don't have.
We can get you that.
It goes from like $230 a month to $750 a month.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't think we charged a rate, but
we just were trying to keep it all the same.
Sorry. Dr. Doxer.
Just to sort of follow up on the RISE questions, you mentioned that there is extended day available for families at Wood End and the high school as part of it. I know we're obligated to pay for our special education students for the school day.
No.
Do they then start to pay for the extended day?
Yes, that
so
is childcare.
So both, okay.
It's not the educational program, that's childcare in the afternoon.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Mrs. Just to follow up on the, continue on the RISE discussion, just a looking at those hourly rates, this curious thing that goes on at the 5-day piece with some of the other providers, but how many classes, we have two classes of the 5 full days, is that, that's what it says here.
Yep.
So is that, I don't know, has the number of days, is that stays pretty stable, and or does it change?
It changes. It depends on parent interest.
Uh-huh.
A lot of parents want full day for their children. I mean, they're looking for daycare, and a lot of those people use before and after school care. People that are looking just for an educational program, the most popular is 3 mornings a week.
Uh-huh. Right. So,
we're meeting a social need as well as an educational need.
And are the how does that work with the mix of students? I'm sorry, my children are all graduates of RISE, but that was a very very long time ago. So
I'm sure they had a good experience.
They did. They had a great experience. But I just what the you know, the mix, how the mix of students with the special needs and then your typical students throughout
the,
all
the
classes.
The maximum, you can have 8 typically developing kids with 7 kids on ed plans.
And
so it's a little less than a half.
Oh, okay. Okay.
All of our classrooms are full. For typical kids, we'll always have space for children with special needs, but all of our typical spots are full.
Mm-hmm. On the previous slide, it didn't happen to list how many were the 4-day, half-day, afternoons classes. All right, maybe it's not the previous slide, the one before that. It lists the number of classes for each, except
but
for
how many students are in.
That's classes. No, the 4 half-days, afternoons, it just doesn't list how many classes.
I don't think we have a 4 half. We do, and I'm missing one there. That's my fault. That Carolyn just copied what I gave her, so it's my fault. we have a 4 full day program also.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
We do have a 4 a.m. and a 4 p.m. They're two school classes.
Yes.
Nobody goes to school between 11 and 12 in those classrooms.
Oh, I see.
And then the other ones go through lunch.
Okay.
All set?
I just want to follow up. Mr. Robinson was raising the issue of the half BCBA, and I think I've received input from parents that are very supportive of that and have had positive experience with the current, by having that person in our district. And it does seem that the cost, certainly the ROI is really strong. So
I wasn't raising issues.
No, you were not issues, just I wanted to follow up and emphasize. I know you were making sure that this was something that had been sort of on our priority and on our radar, and given that we're the team chair was also, and we're sort of cutting the team chair, and yeah, so I just sort of wanted to emphasize that input had come through really strongly too.
Thank you, Mrs. Webb. Dr. Nyan's been waiting very patiently.
Mrs. Wilson, I apologize. I called you Mrs. Walsh, I was told by Chuck the other night, so my apologies. I know who you are. Question on those grants, the IDEA grant, are those entitlement grants or?
Yes.
So if we apply for them and we meet their criteria, we
yes.
get those every year.
Yes.
So we have to count on those to be funded. And as you said, sometimes it's a little tricky.
Right. You don't always know when
yeah.
you're going to release the funds.
Yeah.
So we do our best.
And then I get this question asked a lot, and I think it's worthwhile discussing it, bringing up that if you have the answer, but how do our special ed costs compare to some of the surrounding communities?
I don't really know. I haven't done that analysis. I don't know. I mean, we can take a look.
I mean, I've seen it in the past, and it's usually comparable.
Yeah.
But I just think it's something that oftentimes people ask, and I think
right.
it's good to.
I believe on page 33, if I'm looking at this correctly. Yes, I think it's 33. Again, this is FY15 numbers because the state is a couple years behind. But it does show that with our comparable communities, in FY15 we were ranked 10th out of 13.
Hmm. So we're even lower than the tip of the.
But that's percent of budget, not total budget.
Right, it's percent of budget.
Percent.
Right.
Right, yeah, that's it.
You're good? Dr. Doxer.
I was just going to comment that a frequent conversation at the CPAC meetings was also in reinforcement of the benefits of the BCBA, that people were really receptive and appreciative of the difference that made for their families and programs. I had a question on page 5 of the slideshow, so I'm not exactly sure which. It's under the Walker report, the grant funds, and you mentioned that we have the clinical consultation that was added.
Yes.
Is that being counted under professional development in terms of support? I've gotten a lot of questions on that. The DESE category and the 1.3 million and trying to unpack and understand what that figure means. And I know that our professional development goes across different categories and is found in different places in our budget. And so I was just wondering if that also is considered.
So the, what we are providing right now is being charged through contracted services, so it would not be. I'd have to look and see if the grant, the program improvement grant, if that gets captured in that number. I don't know. Because last year we used some grant funding.
Okay.
So.
And you also, can I ask another question? So you also mentioned, I think that when we offer quality programs in district, kudos to all the work you've done to make that happen, not just for the financial benefits, but for the neighborhood benefits, for the friendships, for the family supports, for all of that. And I just wanted to check in because you said that. I know that different filters work different ways and different parents want different things. Mm-hmm. And so I was wondering, you said two students actually returned this year. Mm-hmm. Have you gotten feedback from that, and are they?
So far, we don't really want to talk about that.
Ms. Dr. Doxer, yeah, that's a very select group of, that would be identifiable.
We've had multiple students return, throughout the year, so I think it's really important that, it really depends on the family and what they are looking for. Many families are looking to come back to Reading and be part of the community, and we want to be able to welcome them back. And so when the students are either ready because they've made that progress, or the families are really looking to be back in this community, we are doing everything we can to make our schools ready for that. And we work really closely with those private schools or the collaboratives as well. So I think that's an important piece. We have wonderful relationships with our collaboratives and with the private special education schools, so that when we are looking to transition students back, our staff are going out to observe the student, their staff are coming in and observing our setting, and we really work closely together to create a smooth transition plan so that students do meet with success. It takes a lot of time, and I think the credit needs to go to those principals, those teachers, those social workers who are doing that work with the family to have that smooth transition.
Thank you. And one more
sure.
quick thing. Sorry, I trespassed too closely on that, but you answered my real question. Yeah. Thank you very much. And I just also wanted to say thank you for this presentation, this window into the programs. Mm-hmm. For me, I've heard many things many times, but you again unpackaged the alphabet soup and brought people to the positions and the programs. And that's very helpful. We're talking about a lot of numbers, but really the reality of this is we're talking about teachers and kids and families and programs. And your approach tonight really highlighted that, and I really appreciate that. Thank you. I know it took a lot of work.
Thanks. I think Mr.
Blavin had some. Yeah, question about the special education staffing slide. Mm-hmm. Either that. One thing, maybe I missed it, and I'm sorry if that's the mm-hmm. case, but it's a little, it's kind of hard for everyone to read up there, but there's a social worker line mm-hmm. toward the bottom, third up from the bottom, and I see that going from a 4 to a 3.
It's a reclassification.
Oh, it's a reclassification. We moved, there was a school psychologist that had been captured in that line that should be in the school psychologist line, which is in regular day.
Okay, so we're not cutting a social worker.
No, we are not.
That person just has a new classification.
Right.
Yes.
The wrong person was put in there.
They're part of the regular day budget now.
Just a second question on the same slide, just on the bottom, just to be clear, how do the team chairs work? You talked about cutting the 0.5, and that you can see the 6.2 going to the 5.7
yes.
there. When I hear the word chair, I think of one person.
Right.
So how does this work that we have 5.7?
So they are divvied up. As I said, at the elementary level, we started the year with 0.5 team chair in each elementary, so they're divided. So. We had staff who were either divided between two schools or some part-time individuals. And then at our middle schools, we have a full-time team chair at each middle school, and at the high school, we have landed this year with a 1.7 team chair. They, at their building level, they are the point person for special education. So they, at the elementary level, are running department meetings with the special education staff. They're monitoring the paperwork and all those timelines and everything that needs to get done around that process. They're in contact with families around the evaluation process. And then they're the chair. They're running each of those initial or reevaluation meetings to ensure we're going through that eligibility process in a real consistent way across the district.
So they take on that leadership role at each of the buildings.
Thank you.
In that capacity. We also have someone who right now currently does out of district. So for the students, we had the number, I think it was about 54 students who are placed in out of district, either collaborative or private special education schools. We're currently using someone who's part-time to manage those cases as well. Anything else?
No.
Carolyn, just on the enrollment trends,
mm-hmm.
that chart.
Yes.
Now, the going from 64 to 53, suspecting a good chunk of that is maybe IEPs. And is there anything you can, actually it's right there, anything you can attribute that to that's successful, that we're doing it at the regular ed level?
I think it does speak to that. I think the work we've been doing utilizing the MTSS framework and the really starting to conceptualize tier one and tier two supports is helping, I think, when you look at the first column of number of students on IEPs. Because when we're looking at now, our teachers are looking at best instructional practices, ways to intervene with students, so they may not necessarily need to go on an IEP. When we look at our out-of-district numbers, what I will say is that is a snapshot in time.
Sure.
So things change day to day in my office, depending on how many IEP meetings and what's happening within the district at that time. I think when you look at the out-of-district, my hope is, and what I'm seeing, is that we are strengthening our programs. We, you know, adding these, I see, you know, you see the numbers of students on IEPs going down, and then you hear me asking for additional staff. Well, because in order to run quality programs, you need qualified staff and you need the right amount of staff.
Mm-hmm.
We can't continue to stretch people thin and provide quality programming in district. So we need qualified staff. We need to make sure we have the right number of staff in our programs. And I think the work that we've been doing with the vertical PLCs, in particular for our special ed programs, is helping with that continuity. Parents, as you know, get very anxious as they move through middle school and on to high school. And because our teachers are working together collaboratively, I think we're helping to ease that anxiety because we're starting to align our practices better to make that transition smoother for students within our programs.
I think it's very good information. And you know, as you said, the out of district is somewhat unpredictable,
right.
But the IEP really shows that things are working,
mm-hmm.
and that's good.
Yeah,
thank you.
It is great. Thank you.
Absolutely. I agree. I have a question about professional development.
Yes.
So I know you zeroed it out from the operating budget. Do you have a sense of how much you would be spending in the next school year, or next fiscal year, I should say, from the grants on PD?
So we have, usually our programming improvement grant has been around $34,000. And then the IDEA grant, we've kind of had a set aside, I think we're about, 20,000 in that grant. So I definitely think, you know, there are some things that we're required to provide. For instance, our restraint training, we use QBS.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have to pay for those staff who are trainers to be recertified annually, and then every staff that has their retraining, they require us to pay a nominal cost. But those are expenses that I'm going to have to build into the grant. But those are things we have to provide. I don't have a choice for providing those. Other PD, as I said, I'm really working closely with my team chairs to map out this year, look at their upcoming needs so we can have, you know, provide what we can. Those two grants go through August 31st, so we'll have some funds this summer to also provide some opportunities for staff. So,
can I ask another question?
Sure.
Not on professional development. I'm very excited about the possibility of some additional BCBA for the reasons that have already been stated. I'm a little bit worried about a 0.5 position.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that person is out there? Because it's such an important qualification.
We're really hopeful that we'll be able to find someone,
yeah.
You know, as soon as, you know, the budget kind of moves on, we can put out an anticipated opening and kind of see what we can get. I am hopeful, you know, sometimes you find people who really do want to work part-time, or some people in these positions also work with other agencies in the afternoon or evening,
mm-hmm.
so they might be looking for something to fill some of their day.
Okay.
So.
Oh, Elaine, thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Borowski. A question on the team chair, the clerical, because prior, when we were looking at what we really needed in the district, we talked a lot about clerical support. So I just sort of want to understand there was a shift in that a person, a different person was brought in at a different salary, but we've never really, we still are, have not provided that clerical support that we had talked about in the fall. Is that true? I just want to understand that.
So the clerical salaries you see in there are for my administrative assistant and for the secretary for the RISE preschool.
RISE preschool, yeah.
Okay, so that total RISE, number.
Yes.
That
so that's the RISE preschool secretary. We brought someone new in, I believe, about a year ago.
A year ago.
Yep.
So she came in at a higher salary.
Okay, but we did not address that need.
We don't have official
no.
clerical.
Because we had identified that the team chairs, part of the, we've had some turnover in the team chairs and there's a huge burden and we were looking to try to provide some additional clerical support so the team chairs could focus on the things that they really need to do with students. And
no.
Okay, so that hasn't been done.
No, it's not been addressed.
Okay, Ms. Borowski, can
yes,
I just?
Yes, go ahead.
I just was looking at the data on the chart on page 61. Which has the special education staffing, and just sort of taking a look at, you know, where are we from FY14 to 18, and I think when you look at, and you say, are we a district who's trying to be focused on students and student needs, when you look at the change in staffing, that's 18 people in that, would be in that four-year time frame, and I just sort of did a quick look of it, 9.5 of them are teachers, 5 are paras, and 1 is a social worker. So I think, you know, it speaks well to the fact that we're trying to really make sure that we're putting resources where they can have the most impact mm-hmm. to students. So I appreciate that because it doesn't happen by accident. And I just had one other question
mm-hmm.
about you mentioned the restraint training. So does the grant cover the restraint training for special education teachers? But didn't we have to do restraint training for
yes,
more teachers?
Yes, we'll have to use the grant, any grant funding.
Yep.
But you can use that for your rate
yep.
for
yes.
all of the
yes,
teachers?
Yes, absolutely.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, because, all right, I just wanted to be clear about this. Yes. So often we have mandates from the state
right.
that come with this much funding.
No,
so
both of the grants are really focused actually on students with
okay.
disabilities and doing professional development for any staff who work with students with
oh,
disabilities.
Oh, okay.
It's
and
not limited to special education
no.
staff.
Okay, good. So with an inclusion model, you want to make sure that you have
yes.
your regular
teachers.
Ed teachers
yes.
who are part of
like
the process.
Co-teaching training we're
mm-hmm.
sending staff to, it is pairs of regular education teacher, special education teacher are going together to the
okay.
training.
Great. Thank you.
Mr. Quick question about therapeutic support program.
Mm-hmm.
How many students are enrolled in that?
Let's see, what was our number is in the chart on page 58. So that program, it's labeled Student Support Program, that
thank
was
you.
The
that's,
old name.
That's all I
need to know. It should be therapeutic support.
Oh,
so
no,
if you look at
another,
3, 7, so we currently, this is a very much a snapshot. I think we actually have more students at Killam, but it looks like 10 students. I think we're probably up at 12. 13 students we have
had a different name
here,
in
so. Segment
42. That's
yeah.
why I was confused.
Yep.
That's the old name.
Dr. Doxer?
Yes, I had
exactly.
two questions. This movement towards the inclusion and the co-teaching model, I'm wondering about the impact of that and this sad state of affairs where we're cutting back on staff and we're cutting back on paras. And I'm wondering about that co-teaching model in the classroom and whether that will be helpful in terms of some of the gaps that are left. As the teachers work together, does that, they're shared. The special ed is not just focused on special ed, although they have their primary focus. They're working together for the class. And I'm just wondering if you could talk a little about
mm-hmm.
that dynamic and how it impacts.
I think it depends on the building. As I said, we haven't really come up with a uniform definition of co-teaching. So that inclusion support in some buildings is that the teacher might be in there for the math instruction, maybe 3 days a week. They're not in there every day. At Birch Meadow, we have special educators who are included in some classrooms every day, all day. At the high school, we have special educators who are co-teaching content area classes, So they'll be moving from the college prep to the strong college prep to provide the co-teaching within that environment. So it varies by building and model and program how that co-teaching looks and sort of what that support looks like. Obviously, in a program like Birch Meadow, where you have a special education teacher in the classroom all day, the level of support they can provide both that classroom teacher and all students in the classroom is very different than if you're going into an inclusion setting 3 days a week for maybe 45 minutes at a chunk. So it's going to vary. But yes, they're there to help improve the instruction for all learners. They need to meet the needs of those students on IEPs, but with having good relationships, the idea is that you'll have two instructors, two professionally licensed people teaching a class. Even if that is for 45 minutes a day, I do think that has a benefit for all of our students, not just the ones on IEPs. So,
thank you.
I wanted to ask a question about figure 25 in the budget packet. It talks about enrollment history for various high needs populations. We've talked about the IEP population. There are other populations in that chart, the first language not English, low-income students, et cetera. Is that part of the topic tonight, or is when were we going to talk about those needs of those students?
That was the ELL teachers are in regular day.
Okay.
But we can certainly take a question from you if you want to put it in writing, and we can research it.
And low-income is... How do you address that within your sequence of presentations for students? Is it just a question of caps and kind of the things you would logically think of in terms of accommodation for people for costs? Are there any other?
Again, if you want to just submit that as a separate written question, we'll
sure.
be more than
I'm just curious whether
happy
there are any
to research
changes
it.
To how we support these other populations yeah. that were relevant. Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Doxey.
I have another question. You, in terms of the impact of the personnel reductions, I know that we've talked at a past meeting about one of the ways we could maximize the bang for the buck is by consolidating sections so that we're reaching more kids. Kid sections with 13 in them might go up to 15, and it's actually, it's triggered, it's not just special ed, it's regular ed as well, and it's triggered by the discussion here on RISE music sessions, sections taught by the music staff in the district. And
yes.
That will result in a reduction of sections and courses at other levels.
Mm-hmm.
So is that working on the same principle where we had smaller classes, the classes will still be offered, it will just be less
offered. Sections.
Less sections of it. Mm-hmm. And so we'll, I know that there's a lot of interest in the music classes. Is that going to shut out a lot of students in the high school when that happens, or will schedules enable?
Sometimes it's the schedule that determines whether or not a student has access to any class. So if you have less sections available, a student may not get access for that reason. Not because the class is too full. So they may be taking something else that meets at the same time. But there'll still be sections of classes available for music. Students will still be able to take music at the high school. There's no change in that. There may not be as many of those sections available.
And we talked about the lessening, the changing of graduation requirements. Is that going to free some students up to take more in a class that they might otherwise not be able to take?
With the incoming freshman class, the suspension of the fine arts and business requirement doesn't mean that students can't take those classes. It means they're not required to take two semesters.
Okay, but by not having that requirement, they might be able to fit in a section that might not fit in their schedule 1 year, but they
yep,
could fit
that's
it in
correct.
Another
yep.
year.
Yep.
Thank you.
Dr.
Since you brought that up, what would the anticipation be of those students that, you know, no longer have to take the required fine arts or business? What would be an alternative course? I know it was specifically mentioned that it would not be a directed study. Are there?
I think I'd rather have Mr. Barker answer that question. I don't want to say something that may not be accurate.
All
I think he would be able to answer that question more appropriately.
Can you submit that one in writing, too?
Yep.
So it can be part of the book. Okay,
yeah, if you could submit it, we'd be more than happy to research it.
So the question about the 0.5 FTE special education administrator team chair reduction, down to the 5.7. You say in your list of consequences in the slide, high caseloads for remaining team chairs across districts, including out of district district placements. How high are the caseloads? And is there a precedent for it? So is this a situation where we had a certain caseload 2 years ago, we added a half FTE, and now we're going back to where we were in the past? Or is this going to be an unprecedented level of number of kids keeps changing?
No, it's definitely not an unprecedented. When I came in, there were much less team chairs. We have gradually increased the numbers. their caseloads vary from about 55 up to 100, a little over 100. It's variable depending on their assignment, whether they work full-time, part-time. So I think we are going, as I said, I think we're going to be at the levels we were last year, which I think was an improvement from when I started. It's not ideally where we want to be in terms of being able to support our families, to support our principals, but it is a level we were at last year, and I think it is a model we can sustain. Again, it's not ideal, but we're going to make it work for the benefit of our students and for our families.
I have a question that kind of it piggybacks on special education students and regular ed. So I'll ask it, and you can answer it now, or we can put it off to be part of the question and answers. It came from actually a parent, an email, concerned about the reduction. This is a regular day proposed reduction of the ELA in sixth grade. So going from two blocks to one, and her particular concern was students with language-based disabilities. It would seem that the structure we currently have is very supportive of its extra direct ELA instruction. So are you at all concerned that going from two to one blocks in sixth grade ELA will be negatively impactful to that population of students?
I mean, it's definitely a concern, but as Dr. Doherty said, we haven't seen the schedule yet.
Okay.
So they're in school the same minutes in the day.
And the blocks are longer.
The blocks are longer.
The periods will be longer.
Okay.
So we need to really see the schedule, but absolutely that does present its own challenges, but we need to see the actual schedule so we can start to work through that piece.
And in most districts, they only have one period of ELA in sixth grade, not two. I'm not saying that's a reason to do it, but that's...
But that's more of a standard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there are some other communities in our area who have a language-based program that might have that model. So I know Linfield does, so we could reach out to them and look at their schedules as well. We're not the only district that provides language-based programming. So we can reach out to other districts and see, do you have a six-period day? How do you do it? And get some ideas. But where we don't have the schedule, it's hard to...
That probably answers my second question then, which is learning center time in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. How would this proposed schedule change impact that?
Those are questions that right now the middle school principals are still working out that schedule. And that's a question that's probably not going to get answered in the near future. Because it's going to take a while for them to figure out all the little nuances of
the six-period schedule.
Mm-hmm.
But it is safe to say that any child on an IEP has federally protected rights, so they will continue to get all services that they are entitled to.
They will continue to get services, and we will work with families as we see the schedule. I've already started talking with the team chairs in both the middle schools. And once we have a schedule, we'll start doing that work. I can't start it right now.
Anything else from the committee I'd like to offer? Oh, Mr. Corum.
I don't know where I'm going with this, but maybe you could slide back to the slide of the city district versus the county district cost comparison for the So I noticed there that it was about $50,000 for the out of district seed collaborative, which is the cheaper option. And the in district cost was about $32,000. So because out of district is accommodating cost, that gets covered out of the town budget straight off the top. Again, looking in the middle of the column, the single student total is $32,000. So if you took the $49,000 and said, okay, we're going to bring in district, so now we don't have that, that $49,000 isn't an accommodated cost anymore. It's subject to the 64-36 split, which actually amazingly almost exactly lines up with $32,000. So it doesn't do any damage to the school district department budget. You're not spending extra money on it. But the $18,000 that was saved all goes to the town side of the budget. So we have about 20 students in that program, according to the budget, mm-hmm. times $18,000, $360,000. So school committee did, or school department did a great job and saved the town $360,000, and all went into the town side of the budget.
When you say,
because it's a comedy.
I don't know. I mean, there are several other.
Oh, okay.
Several other programs. Some of them have private ones that are even more savings by bringing them in district. And I don't know. It's probably a discussion that goes to these FinCom people in front of me.
Yeah. I have a thought, but I'll let Dr. Doherty go first.
And it's something we've already brought up with the town manager. Because of the budget decrease that we had this year in out of district, I think it was like a 2.3% decrease in the accommodated cost, if I recall. It's definitely on his radar, and it's this conversation that we're going to take a look this summer, I believe, at all of the accommodated costs. Because when this model was first put in place, and it was several years ago now, at least 10 years, some of the accommodated costs now may not be the right match. There may be others that we need to put in place that are different. So it's a taking a look at the whole model and seeing, you know, what is it that should be considered an accommodated cost and what no longer really needs to be.
Yeah.
So it is something that will be discussed, I know, after this budget cycle is over.
Thank you, Mr. Cole.
Yeah, Ms. Sampi.
Oh, if you could come up on or near the microphone.
Hi, I'm Michelle Sampi. I just wanted to kind of piggyback on what Jeff was saying, because I know that one of the things you have worked really hard at and are going to be looking at more in the future is risks that our school district could be at risk for.
Yeah.
And I think the out-of-school district tuition, whether it's an accommodated cost and does or does not get reabsorbed into the operating budget, is something that has to seriously be looked at, because special education tuition is fluid and it's really unpredictable, and the costs are always going to be going up. They're not going to be going down. So if it was possible to put that money back into our operating budget, we could build stronger programs and better support our students and our families. Thanks.
Thank you.
And save money.
Anything else on special education budget before we move to the next section? Yeah, sorry, Mrs. Webb.
Clarified here that Mrs. Sampi brings up about out-of-district tuitions. I just want to make sure that I'm right about this, but the way that the private providers, they can reset their tuition, their process for setting tuitions is dramatically different from this budget process.
Correct.
And I believe, I don't know exactly what the timing is, but maybe you could just sort of describe that so that people understand where we are at the mercy. That process.
So basically, for approved private special education schools, not collaboratives, but the private special education schools, they go through a process with the Department of Education similar to us called the Coordinated Program Review, which is done every 6 years. At that point, they are eligible to go for program reconstruction. And they do send out notification to purchasers and invite us to meetings to talk about what changes they can make, but they have the ability to submit to the Department of Education, these are the changes they need, and then the Operational Services Division does the pricing. So the Department of Education will approve the programmatic needs, mm-hmm. and then that goes on to Operational Service Division, who says this is what it's gonna cost. And then we are just notified that their rate is increased. So it's not something that we have. We can attend providers' meetings, purchasers' meetings. I went to the purchasers' meeting last year for one of our schools, and they listened, but ultimately I got the notice that their rate was increasing. And they can go up at a much higher rate. It's not a requirement that they can only go up so much. Although every once in a while, we're kind of put on notice that maybe their rates are gonna be frozen, and then we kind of wait and see what the legislature's gonna do. So you'll have a big notice that says, you know, their rates are frozen, but we don't like to rely on that. We always try to budget for an increase because
You can't anticipate that, and the legislature sometimes doesn't make their decision until like June 29th.
Mm-hmm. In our public collaboratives, we do have a lot more control because each superintendent is on the board of directors, and those usually go up about 2-2.5-3% the tuitions.
Okay. Yeah, Ms. Roberts.
I just wanted to make a comment on the accommodated costs, because I was actually on the FinCom when we put that model in, and it was really structured because of the unpredictable snow and ice out of district. So there's been many years where, you know, that model has helped us. You know, right now it isn't because of it, but so we need to be mindful of that when we decide to go change things.
I actually had the exact same thought in my head.
Yeah.
You'd want to be careful about saying, oh, well, it benefits us now,
right,
so we'd like to change the model. To your point about financial risk, is you know, you go down that road, you're saying I'm going to live with it in 2 or 3 years when it's a huge bump up in cost because of some unanticipated. So it's as Dr. Doherty said, a broader discussion, a good discussion, but a broad discussion. Yeah, Mr. Doxey.
Mark, I just put a question. Do we have...
Mark.
Oh, sorry.
Still a quick question.
Thank you.
Do we have students from other districts that are getting special education services here? And how do we recognize revenue from that?
Yes, we do. So we do have students who are paying tuition to attend our special education program. So they're students who are enrolled in one of our many programs. And the funding goes into our revolving fund, which we pointed out as an offset. So we do take an offset from that revolving account. So I typically work with the director of finance to establish a rate. If the student is getting something very specialized, for instance, they need a one-to-one paraprofessional, we charge that sending district the exact cost of that salary. And it goes into the revolving account, and we pay for that person. And then if the child were to move, that position is no longer with us. So yes, and it's very much driven by space. So we really have to be cautious because, as you can see from our numbers, our programs are getting stronger. We need to make sure we have space for our students. So we really look carefully when we do get a referral, and we also want to make sure we really vet that those students match the population that we have and that we can meet their needs and that they're a good fit for our program. So.
But to Dr. Dox, it's a very, and to Dr. Dox, Mr. Dox's point, it's a good point of, you know, there's obviously enormous cost savings when we're able to bring students from out of district in district, but which is a result of strong in-district programs. But then if you have two extra seats in a program and there's the right match, it's an additional revenue. So it's just one more benefit of the strength. And Mr. Robinson already said it, but some of those numbers are very impressive, so kudos to you. Yeah,
Ms. I have just a question.
Sure.
I just want to kind of give the thumbs up to the BCBA, the 0.5. It's such a huge position. My son benefits from our BCBA. She's fabulous, and I can't wait to see the district benefit from more. The other comment I have is from the special education community. I got a couple comments that I pulled together, put into a letter to just read to the school committee regarding the blocks that might be cut.
Can you make sure, you probably need to be a little closer to the mic, so, because otherwise,
just turn it towards you.
Yeah, sorry, people at home.
You pull up that chair right
yeah,
now.
Just
and then you can get it back.
Oh, God.
And then when you say the blocks, you mean the middle school
the
potential
ELA,
restructuring.
The
okay.
ELA
Just
cut.
Wanted to make sure I knew what you were talking about.
Okay. So, and I apologize. Dr. Doherty, you said it's only... ELA is one block, not two. I got a notice that they get a double block of ELA.
Next year, the reduction would be from 2 to 1, so next year it would be 1.
Okay, so this makes sense. Dear school committee, I address you tonight regarding the potential cuts in the middle school to a schedule of 7 blocks to 6 blocks. As the co-chair for the Special Education Parent Advisory Committee, also known as the CPAC, this will have a direct impact on the LLD kids that need the structured reading and writing times the 7-block model provides. With sixth grade, there was a double of ELA, and this allows all children to benefit from the extra block to work on writing skills. It is a huge benefit to all students, including and especially the children in the Bridge program. Cutting a block will be a huge loss to regular education kids and devastating to the Bridge program. The students would lose the ability to have participate in an elective. If a child wanted to play an instrument in band, they will not be able to. There will not be enough blocks of time. Band requires the music / band blocks more than the art block or chorus block. While an elective may just be that, music can help a child with fine motor skills in other areas of their need. Music can help fine motor skills and language strengthen areas that process math and language, something that benefits both populations. Cutting a block will not allow time for academic support block. In sixth grade, removing the second ELA block means that the Wilson instruction would need to take place during what most Bridge students have as an academic support time. This support time is used to catch up on and repeat instruction from the inclusion classroom. It is also used to start homework with the help of special education teachers or paraprofessionals. If you keep the support time, then lose all the electives, music, art, and band, it would be very challenging for the typical and the Bridge students. The Bridge program students have a need for modifications. They need to review novel concepts and have time for repetition. The repetition helps them to grasp concepts, steps, and strategies. If the district strives to create a program that keeps kids in district, cutting these blocks would do the opposite. Without the seventh block, children are most likely to fall behind and be sent out of district to catch up at a more costly cost, at a more costly school, costing the district more money in the long run. The special education community asks you carefully consider all avenues for budget cuts and take great care in the domino effect cutting blocks out of the schedule would cause. As I stated, it's not only the special education kids that would suffer, but the general population too. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing that. Do you want to address that now, or do you want to put that?
The only thing, and we said it earlier, we don't know what the schedule looks like yet, so I think people are making an assumption based on the current schedule, and it's going to look much different.
That was a concern I had. I heard from you that, well, this is going to mean this, this, and this, and what I heard from Carolyn and Dr. Doherty is they're still working on those details. But what's good about what you shared is that gives them, and they can share with the middle school principals, here are concerns for a very important population of students. How do we make sure they're protected? So thank you for sharing that. Would you mind emailing me and Dr. Doherty a copy of that? Thank you so much. Anything else from the community on special education budget? Really? Okay. District-wide programs, Dr. Doherty.
This evening I do have here people that are directly involved with these cost centers. We have Julian Carr, our network manager, Kristen Killian, who is the director of the department head for fine arts, Tom Zaya, who is the assistant principal for athletics and extracurricular activities, and Lynn Dunn, who is the director of nurses. So all of them oversee these cost centers that we're going to be talking about. So this is 4.2% of the total budget. In this cost center, it really is four mini cost centers in one. The first one is athletics. I do want to talk a little bit about the administrator for athletics, because you will see in the staffing chart there is a slight error. The high school, Tom Zaya's role is actually three different roles and is captured that way in the budget. So 0.5 FTE in the budget is the athletic director piece. 0.25 in the budget, you'll see under staffing for extracurricular, and 0.25 in regular day, I believe, you will see the rest of him as an assistant principal. So there is an error in the budget staffing chart that shows him as a 1.0 for one of the areas, which means he would actually be getting 2.0 salary. That is not the case.
Okay.
But it was a 1.0 at a very
Sorry. So from a budgetary standpoint, pieces of Tom's salary is captured in different pieces of cost centers. So in this cost center, you have the athletic director, the secretary for athletics and extracurricular, and all of the coaching salaries. You have officials, event details, crowd monitors, equipment and field repair and maintenance, the facility rental piece, the transportation piece,
and equipment and supplies. That's under athletics. Under extracurricular, you have, again, a piece of Tom's salary at 0.25 FTE, the advisor stipends, mostly for drama and band, fees, memberships, royalties, and transportation to go along with drama and band, and supplies and equipment. Under health services, you have the director of nurses and the school nurses for the district. We have a school physician, which is a very small salary that really oversees physicals and things like that for athletics, and medical supplies and equipment. And then network and technology infrastructure and maintenance, the network manager and the technicians and technology support that goes along with that. The internet service that we subscribe to, software and licensing, and any network infrastructure and telecommunications repair and equipment. So this is a total of a 7.3% increase. And there's a couple reasons for the larger percent of an increase in which I'm gonna go through. First of all, you have the cost of living adjustments for all represented and non-represented employees. The coaches are actually, and the nurses are in the teachers' collective bargaining agreement, and then you have non-represented employees. There is a proposed increase in athletic user fee in this cost center for the increased expenses in pool rental, ice time, athletic transportation, and the cost of living adjustments for coaches. So that increase is warranting a proposed fee increase, user fee increase. We are also proposing an increase in extracurricular user fee to offset increased expenses in transportation and in stipends in that area. We are reducing one FTE technician in this cost center, a decrease of $35,000 for technology hardware and computer services. And then this is where it gets a little bit tricky. So we are decreasing the athletic revolving account and we are also increasing it so that there is a net decrease of $21,000. So if a fee is approved, an athletic fee is approved, it will result in a net decrease of $21,000. The reason why we need to make this adjustment is to make this revolving account more sustainable. It is possible that at the end of this fiscal year, it will be at a negative balance. So we're gonna be watching that very closely. So we are required to do some changes to this in the future, and it's gonna have to be a combination of a decrease in what we take in the budget, as well as an increase in the user fee for the offset. And then we also are decreasing the extracurricular revolving account by $7,000. It's a much smaller revolving account for a similar reason. So the impact of the personnel reductions, there is one FTE technician. There will be an increase in response time for computer and network repair for schools. We're going from 5.5 to 4.5 FTE. Right now we have a model where we have a technician assigned to two schools, except for here at the high school, where there's one full-time technician assigned, and at Barrows, I believe we have a 0.5 assigned. We're gonna be going away more from that model and more of a ticket base. We do have a ticket system now, but we're going to a more ticket-based model where it will be done based on wherever the issues are and the skill set of the technicians and who can best address that. There's been a lot of efficiencies put in over the last year and a half by Julian through software and other changes and which have helped in this, but we're still gonna see that impact. So here's the budget changes for the district-wide program. Athletics, you can see is going up 25.6%, but that is a combination of decreasing the offset and the increases in the areas that I referred to earlier, which is pool, ice time, transportation, and coaches. Extracurricular, also we're seeing an increase again. Did large percent increases, but also remember, this is a very small cost center. So those increases, again, is a decrease in the offset. And an increase in transportation and cost of living for the adjustments for the stipends. Health services, that increase is primarily the cost of living adjustment for nurses. And
Technology is the one that is decreasing by 8.3%. You see the reduction of a technician and the reduction of the computer equipment line item, which contributes to that decrease. The staffing, this is the corrected chart from what's in the book. You can see that Tom is appropriately categorized as a 0.5. This is in athletics. And then there is that change. The only other change that you would see here is the computer technician is going from 5.5 to 4.5.
And the AP extracurricular is 0.3.
I'm sorry?
The extracurricular AP is 0.3 instead of 1.
Yeah, it's rounded off, 0.25.
Yeah.
Instead of
0.5. So I want to just go into detail. If we go to the budget book, break this down a little bit more for you. So first we'll start with, athletics on page 65. Thank you. This breaks down the professional salaries of the health services. So this is the director and the nurses. These are represented and non-represented salaries. Clerical again. Sometimes when you see larger percentages under salaries, remember that there are steps and COLAs when it's built in, which you'll see sometimes larger increases. There is no increase that you can see in things like substitutes. There is a little bit of a decrease in things like contract services. Our school physician is staying the same. We've been very fortunate that whoever's ever been in the role of school physician has kept that salary the same. And they do provide, some help and services, and particularly with physicals for our athletes, as well as the administration of medication, giving us authority to administer certain medication, right?
Is it still Dr. Green?
No, it's not Dr. Green anymore, no. So that accounts for the 4.3% increase. Moving to athletics, again, you see an increase in the clerical salaries. Those are step and COLA. Same with the coaches. You do see a slight decrease in the event detail. The revolving fund support is what I was mentioning to you earlier. It is a net decrease of $21,000. And when we do talk about revolving accounts next week, we can show you where the athletic revolving account is heading. You also see an increase in the contracted services. That's your transportation, your pool, and your ice rink. So you can see that is the bulk of the increase at 19.6%. Supplies and materials, I believe, is uniforms.
Yeah, we have office supplies.
And some
uniforms,
yeah,
team supplies.
In office supplies, right.
Yep.
And then also we see the athletic services is field maintenance. It's an increase in field maintenance. And then moving to extracurricular, which is on page 68. And you see an increase in the coordinator, which that is actually Tom's FTE. The revolving fund support, we are decreasing slightly by $7,000, again, to make it more sustainable long-term. excuse me. We have an increase in stipends, that's drama and band. Contract services, that's transportation. You can see there's an increase there. And then you see decreases in other areas. And then finally, district-wide networking technology, which is page 69. And you see increase in, if you remember, the network manager is actually, that salary is also split between two cost centers, the administration cost center and this cost center. So I believe it's 0.3 of the network manager's salary is in the administration cost center. And then you see that the decrease in salaries is the technician
the decrease of the technician. And you see that there are decreases in consulting services. We are zeroing out for, it's up here, okay.
Yeah.
We are decreasing the equipment line item on the next page. You'll also see, I should go back, you also see an increase in software licensing and support.
Yeah.
That is the increase that I was telling you about. We've put in a lot of efficiencies, and Julian can certainly speak much more eloquently to this than I can, which has really improved the efficiency of our network and the use of our technicians' time in providing more efficient service for schools. So I don't know if you want to just briefly mention some of the things that you've put in place.
Sure. So we have several new systems that we've added. We put in a full-fledged functional service desk this year, which is tracking all of our work. We have also added a desktop management system, which will allow us to prepackage software applications and distribute them from a central location rather than running around with disks and memory sticks and running things from the network. We can manage our licenses better that way. And then we have a network management system that monitors the status of all of the servers, the network connectivity, the configurations on all the servers and the networking hardware. So we don't have to reinvent the wheel every time something breaks. So it's a lot of network management, if you will, on the back end. And what it's allowed the staff to do is focus on providing services to the users as they are requesting them. We track better what's being requested. We're actually able to pull metrics now on response time and total open time and close time and things like that. We also track now the correspondence on all the issues. So if there's an issue where someone says, hey, you know, this problem is still opening, it reopens the original ticket so we don't get duplicate metrics off of those type of requests and things like that.
So to the user fee increases, which you're also described in the budget book, for athletics, we're looking at an individual student fee per sport of $325. That's an increase of $75. We're also proportionally proposing to increase the individual cap and the family cap by $150 and $225. And you can see that the new fee proposals are there. So it would be an individual cap of $750 and a family cap of $1,175. If you look at the participation, this is also, there was one slight error in the budget book. I believe it was one of the tracks.
It was the outdoor track.
Outdoor track.
And the budget book had a preliminary.
Yeah, that number was much lower than the actual. So the participation rate for 2015-16, which is the last year that we have full numbers, because spring sports haven't occurred yet this year, we're at 1,182 students.
Oh my gosh.
We're on a good pace for 16-17. You know, there are some increases in sports in participation level. And then certainly with the spring season coming, we'll anticipate that hopefully we'll be able to reach the 15-16 levels. So that's the participation rate. For the user fee increases for extracurricular, we're proposing a $25 increase. This is set up a little bit differently because we're talking about band, winter color guard, drama. And drama is broken down into really two types of participants based on the amount of time that they participate in preparing for a show. So your extracurricular band per season, we're proposing to go to $200 with an individual cap of $475 and a family cap of $775. Winter color guard, very similar. Drama, this would again be per show if it's a cast or a lead tech. Both of them are there for the entire drama show from beginning to end. You would see an increase of to 150 with an individual cap of 375 and 575. And then the drama tech crew, which really is only there for the last two weeks leading up to the show, is a smaller rate, $75 with a, again, the cap of 375 and 575. Taking a look at the user fee comparisons for athletics with the other Middlesex League, I know we've had this discussion in the past, and there's always pros and cons to the way a user fee is charged, and every community does a little bit differently. Arlington has a tiered system, Belmont has a tiered system, Lexington and Melrose do. Some do charge, like Reading, a flat fee with a cap. And you can see that they're pretty much all over the place. There are a couple Middlesex League schools that do not charge a user fee, Burlington and Wilmington and Woburn. So you could see the fee is the Millcom, and then the cap is on the right. And you could see the proposed for Reading and the current for Reading are side by side. We also have some similar data for comparable communities. Some of them overlap with Middlesex League because they are comparable, so you can see again that we do have some variation. And Tom, I'm sure, could speak more to this too with his experience with athletic directors' meetings. You know, one of the things you always need to be concerned about if you do a tiered approach is participation levels. And there are some sports that can handle a higher fee. There are other sports, though, that you probably would lose if you charge a much higher fee compared to the cost of running that sport. And we did an analysis several years ago if we did a per student sport based on the cost to run that sport. And there are some sports that would surprise you or less expensive than others. Football, for example, because of the number of students involved in football, actually would have a much lower user fee because there's over 100 participants. So there's always pros and cons to going from a flat to a more tiered system. So we'll now take questions.
Mr. Blavin.
I had a question about the computer software.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is it okay to, so can you just help me understand, so there's a, looks like a, we spent in the budget about $32,000 looking at the chart for this year, and we're talking about the capabilities we built around the network. The additional $50,000 that's in the budget for next year over and above that, to go from 30 to 87, is that to generate new capabilities or to maintain the current capabilities or something different?
It's twofold. One is to maintain the current, what we have in place, but because the services that we're using, the way the licensing is done, it's subscription based, so it's annual. So we pay that fee on a regular basis, annually now.
So the $50,000 is going to be a fee we're going to carry forward from now on every year to maintain these capabilities.
That's correct.
And just to expand on that, we also in November, November, where we presented the first quarter financials, we approved a transfer of additional funds into the district-wide technology budget to. Because we were incurring some of these costs this year, so the year-over-year comparison from the FY17 budget to FY18 budget will be a little skewed from the approved budget because we have actually increased the budget in the current year as well. I think that might have been before Nick joined the committee.
We're seeing a lot in the licensing part of technology now that, you know, in the past we would pay a flat fee and you'd own it forever. Now you really lease everything that you use. Unfortunately, like Microsoft Office 365, we pay a regular fee for that. Adobe's done that as well with their licensing fees. So everything is pretty much going to a leasing model, if you will. You can use the software, but as long as you pay for it.
Just to follow up, is the fee proportional to the number of users that access the service, or is it just?
Yes, it is.
Enterprise.
It's some of the products are licensed by users. So, for example, one of the applications that we use to manage the computers in the district, that is based off of how many computers you're managing. The service desk software is unlimited users because they want people to submit requests, but it's limited on the number of technicians you can have. So we are licensing based on the my team plus the tech integrators, so because they also, we reassign issues to them as well. So we're licensed differently based on either the user community number or the students and the teachers the technicians.
Last question. Did you see an increase in those fees? It sounds like you started this year and you're looking at next year's cost. Did you see those fees go up year over year?
So I actually started here a year ago this past October, and there was nothing here before. So we were doing everything sneaker net, basically. So all of the expenses that we're now actually capturing are an increase because there was none before, essentially. I think that's the best way to answer that.
That's
we have taken money from different line items and transferred in to pay for that. And now we're actually capturing that as an IT line item because it will be ongoing expenses.
I think one of the themes that you've seen across a lot of cost centers so far is that we're trying to get historical actuals. So, and that's what Gail kept referring to as building the budget from the bottom up. This budget is showing the actual historical costs,
yeah.
So that we're trying to put in the number that we feel is going to work instead of going on a number that we feel, we hope will work based on other factors.
I saw that in a few places where when I looked at the FY17 budget number, that's a big increase or a big decrease. And then when I looked at FY14,
right.
15, 16, that number was more in line mm-hmm. with those. So I could see that in some places in the book. Mr. Robinson had a question.
Thank you. I just had a couple of questions on the athletic. Well, first of all, on the extracurricular, do we have a similar comparison for or the
we
other?
We can try to get that information.
Middle
you talk, are you, which one are you talking about? The comparison to other communities?
Yeah, the thing that you
yeah,
did
we
for
can
athletic.
Definitely try to get that.
And on the, when was, I'm trying to remember, was it 3 years ago was the last time we raised the athletic fee?
Yes, I believe so.
And do you remember
two.
What it,
I think it was two.
Was it two?
It was
either
two or three, yeah.
I, 14?
So I guess I'm not opposed to increases, but I like to tie increases more to cost increases, and I think that the only real cost increases that we can identify here are the pool usage and
pool,
the ice time.
Pool, ice time, transportation, and cost of living
right.
adjustments for coaches.
And
comes out to about $75,000.
You know, and part of the reason for the increase is to get the revolving fund replenished.
No, it's two separate things. Although it looks like it's the same thing. The proposed athletic fee increase is for the offset is to offset the costs, the increased costs in pool, ice, transportation,
right.
and coaches. The decrease in the offset is to make it more sustainable long term. So if all those increases didn't happen, we would still be decreasing the offset.
Yeah, but we asked this question last year about the offset, and we were told, no, we're fine. You know, we can, and here we are. You know?
Yep.
I mean,
it was.
I'm venting. And the, of those of the increases, the pool, the ice time, the transportation, and the COLA, what is the biggest percentage of that, the pool and the ice time?
The biggest percent would be the pool. The ice time is minimal. We have, it's been several years since typically it's every 3 to 4 years we get an increase, so we're about due, but that one's not as significant. The biggest was in the pool fees, where we went from a $29 per lane per hour rate to a $45 per lane per hour rate, so that equates to about a $15,000 impact.
And transportation.
And then transportation with the new bus contract, we're also seeing significant increases. Next year alone, the bus fees are going up again in addition to the increase we had this year, so because we're in year two of the agreement. So those are really the two biggest line items that we're seeing the increase in.
I guess just more of a comment. I guess you know, we've talked about this. I guess I just get concerned about this does have an indirect impact on our coaches. When we continue to charge more for something, there's more expectations that aren't necessarily warranted, but they're going to be there for playing time and stuff like that. And I just think that continues to put that pressure. So.
Dr. Nyhan.
I want to say I really, really, really appreciate you putting in those actual cost scale. I think it presents a more transparent budget going backwards. And it would help us, I think, looking at, I don't want to put any additional work on you because I know you worked extremely hard twice.
Because I enjoyed it so much the first time.
The one thing I'm thinking, is okay, what was the budgeted, what did we actually budget in 2014 for that entire line item, and what was the actual cost? And is there a way that we can project, we have to have a balanced budget, but I'm particularly interested in the salary account, the salaries for personnel. Is there a way to make a determination that, okay, consistently we over budget by $125,000, or consistently we're right on the button? Is that something that could be done at some point in time?
Is that specific to athletics or?
No, to regular day, I think, more. I mean,
When we the budget that you see in front of you is actual current employees.
Right, but we know that sometimes come June, you lose a teacher that maybe has been here for 10, 11 years, takes a position elsewhere, or decides to stay home with their family.
Correct.
So that amount right there has been budgeted already, but it could be, I know like in the past we've paid, like a few years ago, you were able to pay for the paraprofessionals to be put back in place based on unanticipated salary, salary.
Because we had 19 retirements.
Right, something like that.
Right.
That you're not always fully cognizant of. I mean, most of the retirements you should know anyways, though, right? Because
right, and our retirements are minimal that we know.
But we do
year.
Lose, I think the average was, I think I heard like 25 people we lose a year. Is that accurate?
Yes. The tricky part is they don't always come in at a much less rate. Sometimes they come in more expensive. When we got, because I've always told the building principals, I want you to hire the best person.
Right.
I don't think we want to start going down a road where we're looking for the least expensive employee. We want to hire the best person.
Right.
So sometimes we do get some savings. Other times we don't. We actually hire someone that's a little bit more expensive.
Correct. But what I'm saying is, at the bottom line, at some point or another, you can determine that, we had, 250, I'm just throwing numbers out there, $125,000 in extra salary that was available for, we're going to purchase whatever, something from regular day, we're going to purchase the science kits or whatever, the remaining science curriculum. So I'm just thinking, we're in such a tight,
right,
budget year, as you all know, but if we could make an estimated, we've kind of concluded that you know, we can maybe expect $125,000 that we're not going to spend, and that could be particular.
Yeah.
Could be a position.
The danger with doing that is actually something that happened this year. When you have a person that goes out on medical leave, which we don't budget for those, you know, long-term medical leaves, and you're carrying the salary of the person out on medical leave plus the salary of another person that you have to bring in and pay them a comparable rate for the position that they're in. And we had a situation this year with an administrator that went out on medical leave and we had to hire another administrator. You're carrying a double salary. That's when sometimes that savings that you're referring to allows us flexibility.
Right.
It's not an exact science.
I agree. But I'm just saying it would be nice to have a ballpark figure to see if it's something we could look at.
We can certainly try to look at it, but I
hear everything
yeah.
you say. I know I've been through it myself. I know what you're talking about. But I think it would be interesting to see if there's any consistencies in that area.
This lady's Dr. Doxer.
Thank you. Under the contract services, I've been here a while, although not as long as many, and I remember my kids cutting their feet on the bottom of the pool outside on the gunite, and the whole process of having to decide to give up our town pool to enable the Y to build their pool through the generosity of the Burbanks. And I remember back then that there was an agreement in terms of a discount on the pool for Reading families. And I didn't know, I think I know the answer to this, but I just thought I've gotten this question from other people as well about the cost of the pool going up from $29 to $45 an hour for Lane. Are we still receiving a discount for our participation, our use of the pool, given our being founding members, or is it?
Which one of us wants to
answer? I believe right now that we're on their regular rate. I think we may get some preferred times, but I think we're on their rate.
There was a sunset clause on that.
There was.
Yeah.
Oh,
and
it
sunsetted this year.
I was wondering about that.
Which is spike.
Yes.
And John became the leader there, but that didn't help us out, I guess.
No, we actually had this conversation, I think, his first day on the job, so
mm-hmm.
I don't think it was...
it's driven from Boston. Their rates are driven also from their part of the Boston Y, so it's not just the Burbank. I think the good thing, though, is they only need the number of lanes based on the number of swimmers, so at least it's not a fixed rate, correct?
Yeah,
so if there's... only, unfortunately, 14 swimmers on the team, they don't need four lanes. You know, they'll do two lanes or three
lanes. We're still, for right now, been at that. The Y does want to have some two lanes open
right.
for their own membership as well. So they won't let us have for the girls program right now, they won't let us have the whole pool.
Right, we have only
yep.
four or five,
mm-hmm.
which crowds our swimmers when you have over 33 per
yep.
on the team.
And we were able to give credit, we were able to work very closely with them. The initial proposed fee was
yeah,
actually
it was
significantly higher than where we...
How much was it
going to
be?
65.
Yeah.
Was one of the numbers where they started at, and then we could have worked with them.
Might be a nice time to point out we've had some real success with our swimming athletics this year, so good job to them. Yeah.
Thank you, Ms. Borowski. Just a question on the... back to the athletics, transportation, and busing. I think we talked about this earlier, but not tonight while we're talking about athletics, that one of the things you looked at in terms of reducing the transportation costs was, would there be, could you get a benefit if the non-league, you know, we have league meets and non-league, and I think that you guys looked into that. So I just wanted to make sure that I understood what that evaluation was.
We looked into reducing the number of games or events
okay.
per sport as a way to perhaps some cost savings. We ended up somewhere between $15,000 to $20,000 it would have saved us. However,
It's not, again, a firm number because there's a lot of factors that play into that, such as you have Title IX. You need to make sure that whatever you're offering for female sports and male sports for the number of games or events or matches is equal. You also don't get exactly the same, and correct me if I'm wrong, Tom, cost and transportation, because you know, there's a shared bus right now sometimes for events, but if you cut it down, sometimes you still need that bus.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, you know, we figured our best guess estimate was somewhere between 15 to 20,000 if we reduced the number of games and matches in each sport.
Mm-hmm. And so decided that was risky. That wasn't even a very solid number. And then I know if you eliminate the like non-league, sometimes those are some of the, you know, most enjoyable competitions for the kids, because it's sort of, they can really have some fun with it and get a great, great competitive event.
Yeah, I think depending on the sport, the way the sport is set up, the non-leagues are as important as the league meets,
yeah,
or the league events.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that was kind of a slippery slope to eliminate non-league.
Right. Okay.
Can Dr. Nyan ask a follow-up on that one, Mrs. Webb?
Oh, yeah, I'm
okay,
all done. Thank you.
And I think just to add to that, what John said and Tom just said is that you can put the athlete at a disadvantage if he doesn't or she doesn't. Let's say in tennis, for example, if they don't do an out-of-league tennis match, they may not compete against one of the better high-ranked players, and therefore, you know, when she goes or he goes to the states or the sectionals, however it's run, they may not get seated as high as they should have if they had the opportunity to play
right
against them. And that's pretty consistent, I'd say, almost in every sport. Would you say, Mr. Zaid?
Yeah, I think we do need a minimum number, and I think there's the benefit of that didn't
pay out.
We were looking for alternative ways not to have a user fee increase or as great of a user fee increase. We also looked at, you know, again, these were all models that we looked at, was if we reduced a level of a sport. The problem with doing that is you actually have to not only cut the expenses, but you'd have to cut more than that, because the athletes are paying a user fee, and if they're no longer participating in the sport, that's a decrease in revenue,
yeah,
for the revolving account and for the expenses. So it's almost a double hit when you do something like that. So that's why we kind of nixed that model as well.
I wonder if you would also create another problem. I'm thinking out loud, and maybe not, but if you were to cut a sport, wouldn't some percentage of those kids go out for a different sport, and now you've got oversubscription in other areas?
Yeah,
and
they may.
You know,
they may.
That could be another problem, is just the sheer fact that we want as many kids who want to participate in athletics to have that opportunity.
Right. Yeah. And again, you have to be careful that you offer an equal number of sports for male and female.
Right,
and
right. I noted that the three communities that don't charge fees for this are Burlington, Wilmington, and Woburn. Is that potentially because of commercial base?
Yes.
Oh.
No,
so
there
is a lot of people in the room have been following this for a long time, and I think everyone knows that is one of the structural challenges we have in Reading, is if we had a deeper commercial base. So. Okay. Yeah, Mr. Blavin.
Yeah, I had a question about the YMCA swim fees and a question about the family caps. So on the swim fees, it strikes me, did we raise the idea that what if a participant from our schools is also covered by a family membership at the Y? Probably for insurance reasons, this may not work, but I'm curious. So if that student showed up, they could swim for free at 5:30 in the morning because their family's paying $85 an hour, at least mine does. So I can show up at 5 in the morning, go swim at the Y, and I don't pay for it other than my monthly membership. So if we have half our team where the parents happen to be paying family memberships, can we identify those students and say, look, these kids can swim here for free based on the family membership. Can we get some kind of a prorated discount season over season? Because this is a pretty steep increase.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just wondering if we've tried all the tricks we can to try to get this price down.
I have not looked into
so it's
that,
it's free if you have a family membership. So it's just for insurance reasons. They may be under a different insurance policy.
Yeah, and I'm not sure how they do it, because it's not a per it's a per lane, so I'm not sure how we could
tell them to swim in the other lane. It's free.
So, just, I think it's good to look at, but technically that time,
yeah,
in the morning, if they're swimming in the morning, it's 18 and over. But in the afternoon, when we do swim, it's any.
That's good to know.
So that it could apply, but
It's a good question.
We can
it's a good follow-up.
Question about the caps, then, was my other question. So both for extracurricular and for athletics. So it looks like we're raising the athletic family cap by $225. That's what I'm seeing here.
Yeah, it's a proportionate to the increase.
And so my question is, how much revenue would you expect to lose if we did not, if we kept the increases that you proposed but kept the family caps unchanged, both for the extracurriculars and for the athletics? And
we could
follow up with
that.
Thanks.
Yeah, Dr. Docks.
On page 65, I had a question about the substitute line. I know there's been a lot of theories about ways to save on substitute teaching, whether it be using technology and or centralizing students so that one substitute could monitor what's happening. Can you talk a little bit to, I know that you've done a lot of thinking, I know things have been ruled out for various reasons, but could you talk a little bit about?
This is nurses.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's only nurses?
Yes.
Sorry.
It's in the health services program.
Well, I was talking nurse, substitutes in general, so maybe that comes up at another time.
Regular day.
Sorry.
It was in regular day.
Yeah. That was in regular day.
Sorry.
Sorry, you can't
didn't
ask
it then. I missed my chance.
But we'd be more than happy if you put it in writing to answer that question.
Will do.
And I'm putting that exact question in writing, so he'll get it from multiple. I'm asking that exact same question, so it's a good one.
She missed it too.
Oh, no, no, not on that grid. I'm saying I'm putting in writing for regular day. Your thought process is good. anything else from the committee?
No.
All right, Mr. Doxer.
Hi, I'm Mark Doxer.
Hi.
Question, as a lot of the license fees for Microsoft are kind of shifting upward, there are things like Google Suite that's starting to show up also, which I would imagine, and you may have mentioned this, I imagine the costs are much, much less to get Google Suite going. And the reason, it may not be a now, but I think things are changing quickly. I can give an example. My students over at Northeastern are all doing things on Google Suite. They're not playing with Microsoft products anymore. Just wondering if that's something to watch, and it may be an opportunity at some point to get rid of these crazy license fees.
I just had a follow-up question to that, actually. Great point. The town, does the town use similar systems, and how do the rates for the schools, if so, compared to what the town's getting, and is there an opportunity to negotiate a lower rate?
So the difference between the town and the school system is difficult to compare because we have an incredibly high discount on Microsoft licensing. Coming from the corporate world, we are practically using Microsoft services for free. And that includes everything that Microsoft sells. It's not just Word and Office and things like that. We get access to all their server technology, and everything is included in our license agreement.
The town manager is always enviable that he can't.
He goes the other way.
So when, you know, the administrator for the town and I have had lots of conversations, and he's about like how he can change his environment to do what some of the things we're doing are. Like, for example, we've completely eliminated on-site mail services completely. All of our mail services are now based in the cloud, so we don't maintain servers here. We don't maintain that that license anymore on that server. All of that stuff is gone. It's now a cloud-based solution, which, you know, it's arguable what the savings are there because it goes from, you know, into now a service fee, whereas you had before you had the hardware cost and the electricity and the cooling and the maintenance and all that stuff to go with it. But what I'm seeing is from an administrator's perspective, it allows me now, because we're a school system, to focus on providing services to our users rather than becoming a technology company where I'm servicing equipment all day long.
On figure 51, on the stipends.
What page is that?
I'm sorry, 65 or
68.
I gotta upgrade my glasses. Is that for athletics and extracurricular, or just extracurricular, the stipends line?
This is extracurricular.
Did we talk about, I missed why that went up.
That's
I know it's COLA and that's thing.
And that's back. Another instance where we are looking at the current productions and what we actually are currently paying people. And if you look at 15 and 16, it's actually not increase.
And so it almost looks like we under-budgeted last year. If you look at prior years, that's more typical.
Is that because we thought we'd do less profits?
All right.
So this is, this actually, we
more
actually
truth
went
in budgeting, right, this year?
Yes.
Just, we actually went back and looked person by person what we actually are paying, and it was reasonable based upon looking at the prior couple of years.
Oh, yes.
So there's no change in the planned change in the number of productions if the fee increase goes through?
The number of productions stays the same.
I wanted to make a follow-up comment to your, what you were saying, Mark. It occurred to me after you stepped away that the Microsoft licensing that we pay for does include all of the server-side things. So even if we spun off the desktop services to Google, we would still have to pay for that. So that's I know that a lot of, I mean, a lot of the other school districts I've seen have standardized on the Google apps. There's a completely different overhead to supporting that model. But it's worth certainly looking into it.
I think you're, to your point, your town counterpart is in real trouble because they're paying retail.
Yeah.
And they're looking for a solution.
Right. Yeah. We can just somehow classify the town as an educational institution.
We're all learning.
We'd solve all
it'll
the problems.
There you go.
Was there anything from anyone tonight about these cost centers? Anything else from the committee?
We're going to stop there this evening.
Yep. I was going to say there's some slides here.
There are, but we'll save those when we start doing questions.
Sounds good. Yes, Mr. Robinson.
Move to go into executive session.
You got to read the whole thing.
Okay, for the approval of minutes not to return to open session.
Do you have a second?
Second.
Dr. Knight?
Yes.
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 Yes, Mrs.
Hi, good evening.
Thank you.